I'm Yana Trafalis, and I work for the Athens Institute for Education and Research, which is a world association for academic service leaders. I'd like to welcome you to Athens Interview Series, where we interview the participants at its under conference. Today I'm going to be interviewing Dr. Wim Janssen, who is an emeritus professor at the University of Amsterdam. Hello, welcome to Athens.
Good morning.
Good morning. So can you give me a brief academic introduction of yourself?
Yes, it's not going to be that brief because my career is rather uncommon. Mm-hmm. I started as an engineer, Master of Science in Engineering, Aerospace Engineering. Worked for 25 years for the European Space Agency as an aerospace engineer. In the meantime, I completed my hobby and took an MA in Comparative Linguistics because I was interested in a very peculiar and special language, which is Basque. Mm. And at the end of my aerospace career, let me put it this way, when I could step out, let's say, on convenient conditions, I started a second career. And I was nominated to a chair, a special chair, at the University of Amsterdam, which deals with man-made languages, artificial languages, or constructed languages, which was another, let's say, hobby of mine. And I held the chair for 11 years and left it about 4 years ago. And I continue my research now as an emeritus researcher for the same linguistics research group of that university. So I migrated from engineering through Basque to artificial languages back and forth.
So what's your current major area of research?
In the field of artificial languages, I continue research in the area of the dynamics of Esperanto. Esperanto is the one and only constructed language which has developed from a project into a living language. Living language of a community of speakers, and being a living language, it changes. It changes spontaneously. It does not change by decree. And what I'm interested in is how does it change? Not so much the lexicon, because the lexicon is subject to an automatic refreshing cycle. For new things, we need new words. But what is more hidden is the grammar. What are the small changes step by step in the grammar which are introduced by the speech community without being told to do so? And where do those changes lead to? And what can we learn from those changes? Do the same or similar changes occur in real ethnic, living ethnic languages? That's one thing. And the other thing is in the field of Basque. I'm completing research now in the field of Basque Dutch language contact through the centuries in the field of loan words, etymology of the lexicon, and things like that. So those are my main topics of research.
Okay. So what did you present at the conference? And tell us a few words about it.
Yeah, at the conference I presented a short summary of a study I made in the field of the dynamics of Esperanto and what can we learn from that. Mm-hmm. And I called it the limits of language planning. So I think my presentation was the only one, or one of the few ones, concentrating on the planning aspects, the constructing aspects of a language, the making of a language, and not so much the planning of the status or the planning of the education or the planning of identity through language, but actual language making, which is not an uncommon thing because language make or language reforms occur in many, or probably most languages all over the world. Spelling reforms, the loss of declension systems, cases, and what have you. So simplification of morphology, those things are every now and then formalized by academies or institutes, and that is, let's say, a human intervention in language. And what I presented here was trends in Esperanto, unplanned changes in the grammar, in the way people handle the grammar, and what that leads to. So there are two aspects here. One is workability. The old question used to be,
can we make the language? Many, many people were and continue to be skeptical about the very fact that and can be made and can be converted to a living language. That's one thing, the workability. I think that question has been answered, as Rwanda has lived for 130 years and it works to the full satisfaction of its speakers. But the other thing is the sustainability. It is a living language and the Esperanto speakers are proud of that fact. But a living language changes. And what do the changes mean? Can the changes be channeled, stopped, or should we allow them to continue? Esperanto was designed with a very particular objective, that is to be easy to learn, to be regular, to be rule-based. Are there any changes which undermine that basic design concept? And so that is what I presented in a nutshell in 50 minutes.
Okay, so has Esperanto changed since you said?
Oh yes, it has. It has, yes. Not visibly, many speakers don't even notice that, but it has changed and it is changing. And some of the changes follow a universal trend which can be traced in other ethnic languages as well. And that in a way is encouraging because it means that Esperanto behaves like other languages. Whether that's a good thing or a bad thing is another thing. Probably we shouldn't even use the terms good and bad when we speak about language.
So what made you so interested in this? I'm curious.
Yeah, that's a long way back. I mean, my father used to be the follower of the idea that a language like Esperanto was a good thing to learn, was a good thing for humanity to have a single, impartial, unbiased, neutral tool for international communication, so that we are not forced to speak, let's say, to learn each other's, let's say, difficult foreign languages. And I mean, that idea was, let's say, more or less transferred to me unconsciously. I took an interest in Basque because I traveled through the country a few times, and the very idea of facing a language, which is the oldest language in Europe, of which we do not know where its roots should be found. It has no, let's say, link, no genealogical link to any other language in Europe or anywhere all over the world, and that in itself is an interesting feature to face a language from the Stone Age, so to speak. Yeah, so yeah. It's purely an intellectual interest that drove me, that's all.
So how are you introduced to Aachener and what made you to the conference? Is it your first time at the conference?
It is my first time. I was invited, or I got into contact with Aachener in 2014, and actually I submitted an abstract for the 2014 conference, but I had to cancel my participation for family reasons. I couldn't, let's say, do my preparations the way I wanted them to do, go for family reasons. And so I had to withdraw. But since 2014, I have been receiving every now and then some information from Athens on what was coming in 2015 and 16 and 17. And for 17, I decided, well, I'll try again because you know, I was kindly, let's say, my abstract was kindly accepted in 2014, but I had to withdraw for family reasons. So now I register with a new abstract and a new thing, which was accepted, and here I am.
Okay, so tell me a few things about the higher education system in the Netherlands. And what do you think are the advantages of this?
Well, it's a very diversified system, and it's quite a while ago when I was a subject or a victim myself of that system. But in general terms, the education system is open, is well organized, is up to date, is open to the world, which is not surprising because the Netherlands are a nation of sailors and traders like the Greeks. So we share, let's say, these features which we have in common, I think. It is open. Illiteracy was banned a long time ago. I don't even remember when. It was well before my time. And I think most young people nowadays complete secondary education to some extent. We have a
very diversified system which allows you to, let's say, to change from one line to another, so to speak, at different, let's say, steps in your career. So the advantage is the diversity, the accessibility to all, and its versatility on the other hand. I wouldn't like to talk any about advantages. Mm-hmm. There are also, at least what I see, disadvantages or negative trends, and that is related to language or to country. I think on the whole, the focus in education in Holland is too utilitarian. There is insufficient focus on the cultural aspects, the famous Bildung, and you know, many, let's say, innovations in education are driven by magic words like money, management, business, and as though the main thing in education was to educate people to get a well-paid job, and not to educate people to become happy citizens of the world. And that is a trend which you see, well, all over the place, not only in education. In education, the other thing is the domination of English, which I think is a bad thing. It's a good thing that people learn foreign languages, but Holland used to be a country with its own language, Dutch, which is not a minority language in 20 million speakers, and with a vast knowledge of English, French and German from the secondary school system, secondary, let's say, education level. That has changed over the last 30, 40 years, and Holland is rapidly becoming bilingual rather than four-lingual, so to speak. And that, I think, is a very negative trend. I would prefer Dutch researchers to research and to publish their research in Dutch with good summaries in English and possibly also in other languages. And I would wish the Greeks did the same thing and then the Brits did the same thing, but they don't. Which means that in education a lot is lost in terms of, of, let's say, oral transfer of knowledge. A lot is lost in terms of nuance, shades of meaning, humor, irony. It all goes lost because you don't master it. I don't master English. I don't master English as a native speaker. So I say what I'm telling you now is what I've learned to say more or less correctly. But I can't use the words which I would use in Dutch.